Nick, and welcome to my presentation about Cold War cryptography. Well, I'm Klaus Schmäh. I'm a German crypto history specialist, blogger, and author. And in my spare time, in my day job, I work for a German cryptography company named CryptoVision. And if you want to know more about me, check my website. Here's my agenda for today. I'm going to start with one-time pad encryption in the Cold War. And let's go back now to the year 1953. In this year, West German merchant and passenger ships were required to establish a cipher for radio communication in the case of a war. Well, hopefully, the case of a war is a rare one, so this was not for everyday communication. It was a measure for the case of a crisis, for a war. And it can easily be imagined that if there was a German ship, let's say, sailing on the Atlantic Ocean, and when a war broke out, of course, it was necessary to have a way of secure communication between the ship and its home base in Germany. And this is something that was to be established in 1953. Well, basically, this was not too difficult, because in the 1950s, a couple of quite good encryption machines were on the market. You see a few of them here. I will come back to them later. And now the main question was, which of these machines could be used on a ship? Well, the task was to purchase, let's say, 1,000 copies of a certain machine and give one copy to each ship. And this could be used in the case of a war. This was the plan at first, but then the German cryptologist came, Otto Leibrich, who worked for the German cipher authority, and he said, well, we don't need a cipher machine at all. Instead, we can use a manual system, the one-time pad. And this is not only cheaper than using machines, it's also more reliable. So what is the one-time pad? I'm sure many of you have heard of the system. It's still very common today, at least in cryptography lessons. So it's not really used in practice anymore, but it's in theory still a very interesting system. If you want to know how it works, well, let's first look at plain text. We'll take we approach Sine. Then we need a key. In the case of the one-time pad, the key is a random letter or a random number string as long as the message. And encryption is simply adding the one to the other, letter-wise. And to do so, we identify the letter A with the number 0, B is identified with 1, and so on. So it's not very difficult to add the key and the plain text letter-wise. Here's an example. If we take our plain text, we approach Sydney, and if we take our key, which consists of a random letter string, we simply add it. For example, the B, as I said, is identified with the 1. That means W plus 1 is X, of course. And the D is identified with the 3. That means E plus 3 is an H, of course. So it's a pretty simple system, but the nice thing about it, it is absolutely secure. It cannot be broken if the key is really random. And this is because every message of a certain length can be encrypted to every ciphertext of the same length. So even if you find a candidate for the plain text, if you want to decipher it, you can't distinguish the real solution from a false one, because every plain text can be the result. So the only possibility to decrypt it in the correct way is knowing the key. And if you don't know it, it's not breakable. And this is the nice thing about the one-time pad. And how can the one-time pad be used on a ship in the case of war? Well, this is what the Germans came up with in 1953. They said, well, the captain of the ship at the beginning of the journey receives an envelope. It's for the captain only. the content is top secret, and of course the envelope is sealed, and the captain keeps this envelope probably in his safe in the captain's cabin, and in the hopefully unlikely case of war, when he needs to communicate with his home base, he takes the envelope, opens it, then he takes this piece of paper out of it. It's a form. It contains some space for the plain text, some space for the ciphertext, and it contains the key, of course. And now he takes a pen, writes his message into the form, then he adds the key to the message. He has to do it manually. This is a little work, but it's a rare case, as I said, so if it takes him 10 minutes, that should be okay. And then he receives the ciphertext. He takes this ciphertext and sends it by radio communication to his home base in Germany, and his colleagues in Germany, of course, know the key, so they can decrypt it, and this is how encrypted communication can be established in the case of war. No cipher machine was necessary. Well, of course, the producers of cipher machines now hated Otto Leibrecht because they wanted to sell hundreds or even thousands of their expensive machines. And now instead, the Germans used pen and paper. So this was not especially what the sales guys had hoped for, but it did its job and it was used at least for two decades. Well, this is the one-time pad, and the one-time pad in the Cold War in the 1950s was not only used on merchant ship. It was used virtually everywhere, in the military, in the diplomatic area, wherever encrypted messages had to be sent. The one-time pad was usually the most attractive method because it was secure, and, well, it wasn't really simple, but it was simple enough to be used. But still, if large amount of messages were sent, it became a little laborious, or it was not very practical to use the one-time pad manually. So what happened? Machines were constructed for using the one-time pad. This means these cipher machines producers who were angry on Otto Leibrecht because of his idea with the pen and paper, now could earn money in another field because they could construct one-time pad encryption machines. Here's an example. It's a Siemens one-time pad device. Here you see the word key tape. Basically, this is the key tape. That means the key, which is a random sequence of letters or numbers, is provided as a ticker tape, and the message is provided as a ticker tape too. And the main purpose of this machine was to add the message and the key, and this was feasible with the technology of the 1950s, and this is what these machines did. Here's another example, also from the 1950s, the German one-time pad device, the Mehlemischer. Again, the key was provided on these ticker tapes. And, well, it worked quite well, and especially it was secure because, as you all know, the Enigma was broken in World War II. This was not known to the Germans in the 1950s yet, but still they were looking for more secure ways of communication, and other nations did so too. So this was in the 1950s the method of choice. And of course, if one uses the one-time pad, large amounts of random letters or random numbers are needed. And this means one needed to construct random generators. So I'm going to show you a nice random generator here. It's called Violin, also a German design from around 1950. As you see, it's a pretty simple design. The device is made out of wood. It looks a little bit like a board game or something like this. Here's a similar device. But in fact, it's a random number generator. And, well, today, collectors pay a lot of money for these devices. Not very of them have survived. To my regret, I don't have enough money to buy something like this. So what I did is I constructed and built one myself. I used Lego bricks for it. Well, it's a little simplified, but it still works, and I can use it to tell you how this random number generator works. Well, basically, you need these chips or coins or however you want to call them. You have a set of coins. You distribute them on these five chambers, in a random process, of course. Then you take the violin and tilt it, and then all the chips will move to the right side, and they finally will fall into place, and this is the random sequence we get. In this case, it's 1, 8, 8, 1, 9, and so on. And this is a random sequence we can use to encrypt radio messages, for example. This is the violin. Here's another picture of a similar model. Well, while this worked perfectly, and I think it's quite a good quality of random numbers you get from such a random generator, but it was, of course, not very productive. You wouldn't like to use this to encrypt a long letter of a few thousand characters. So other systems had to be invented, for example, or especially machines were needed, random generation machines. Here's one example, the so-called Hasardo from 1950. I wish I could tell you exactly how it works, but as far as I know, it's still classified. I don't have any information about the details. I only know that it's based on diode noise, and it could be used to generate quite a considerable number of random numbers, and it was used heavily in the 1950s. It could be used to produce ticker tape with random numbers. It did it automatically, and this could be used for communication. Now, well, when the one-time pad was so popular in the 1950s, of course, large amounts of key material had to be transported. Basically, this ticker tape had to be carried by couriers all around the country or to foreign embassies or wherever. And this was, of course, a lot of work and needed some sophisticated logistics. So there were, in the 1950s, cryptographers who occupied themselves with reproducible random numbers. So today one would call it a pseudo-random number. And I will show you an interesting pseudo-random number generator from the 1950s. It's called the Reihenschieber. It looks a little bit like a slide ruler, but in fact, it's a random number, or to be more precise, a pseudo-random number generator, a device that produces reproducible random numbers. So it's based on a key. So if the sender and the receiver have the same key, they can produce the same random number sequence. And so it's possible for the sender to encrypt something with a one-time pad, and the receiver can decrypt it if he has the same random sequence. And well, it was pocket size, so it was about this size. You could put it in your pocket. Well, quite useful. And the random sequence that is produced can be read from this stencil. And again, these Reihenschiebers from the 1950s are today sought after collectibles, so you pay a few hundred dollars at least, or a few hundred pounds or whatsoever, for such a device. I will show you later. I have created a simpler version. But let's first look at how such a device worked. So let's assume these are 8 slides. It's a little simplified. The real Reihenschieber has more, but in this case, we say we have 8 slides. And the first part of the key is choosing 4 of them. So in this case, the key would be 1, 3, 6, 7. This means we choose these 4 slides. The second part of the key is the order in which these slides are used. Then the third part of the key is the face. Each slide has 4 faces. You can rotate it, of course, let's say by 90 degrees, 180 or 270 degrees, or not at all. This is key dependent. So let's say this is the way we turn these slides. And now we need the stencil. It is put, or the slides are put into the stencil. And then each slide is shifted. This is why it's called slide shifter. This is also key dependent. And now we have a random sequence. The random sequence is W, R, F, and so on. And we can use this random sequence as a one-time pad key. So if we have plain text, let's say Baltimore, we can add the plain text to the key, and we receive the ciphertext. This is how a slide shifter works. Well, the real one has more than only 8 slides. It has 25 slides, and 10 of them have to be chosen for the stencil, dependent on the key. And here you can see the numbers. Well, on my model, it were letters. Here we have numbers, but the principle is the same. 6, 5, 3, 5, 6, and so on. This is the random sequence that it generates. And as I said, these slide shifters or reinschiebers are quite sought after at the moment. So, as I said, I don't have the money to buy such nice collectibles. So, I made one myself with Lego bricks. And this one has, as you see here, 8 slides. 5 of them have to be chosen. But it proved too simple. So I encrypted the text with it and introduced this text as a challenge on my blog. And I think it took about 2 hours or so before a reader had solved the message. So this model is certainly too simple. But if you have one with 25 slides, 10 of which are chosen, it's a lot more difficult. And as far as I know, the Reinschieber is quite secure, if you don't take too much random from one key. So it's a very interesting device, but of course a little outdated now. So around 1960 or so, electronic cipher machines came up, and so the time of the one-time pad more or less ended, because electronic systems could implement advanced encryption algorithms that were not dependent on random numbers, or at least not on pure random. Some of them implemented pseudo-random generators, but the time of the pure one-time pad was now over. And this is why we get to the next chapter. This is about the golden triangle of encryption machines. Well, so let's come back to these cipher machines. I already mentioned that a few of them were available on the market or were built in the 1950s. And many of them were quite similar to the one-time pad concept. Many of them used, like you can see here, wheels to construct or to generate pseudo random number sequences. And the key, or the wheels produced reproducible random numbers, and the key was determined by the starting positions of these wheels. It's similar as with the Enigma. You know that the Enigma has these wheels, but the wheels are used completely different here. There are no wires that go through the wheels. In this case, it's more that a random sequence is produced. But again, the starting position of the wheels is used like a combination lock. The sender and receiver need the same combination. Then the machine can produce the same random sequence, and the encryption and decryption can be done. And in this case, the key would be a sequence of 6 numbers or 6 letters, depending on how the machine is constructed. So when a country, let's say, or let's say a military organization or a secret service somewhere in the world wanted to use one of these machines, they always had 2 possibilities: make or buy, of course. The larger countries like the UK or Germany or the USA usually designed and built their machines themselves. But the smaller countries, they usually purchased them on the market. And now the question is, well, which machines were available on the market in the 1950s, let's say? And this question is quite easy to answer. So let's look at this map of Switzerland. In Switzerland, there was a company named Crypto AG, located in Zug, near Zurich. And Crypto AG was the market leader for commercially produced cipher machines in the early Cold War. There was another company named Gretag in Regensdorf, Switzerland. They also were quite successful in selling encryption machine on the commercial market during the early Cold War. And then there was a company named Brown Boveri in Baden, Switzerland. They also sold cipher machines. And these three companies were located in an area of about 200 square kilometers. And as far as I know, they had about 90% market share of all commercially sold cipher machines in the early Cold War. So in the early Cold War, there were basically two possibilities. Either construct a machine yourself or buy it in Switzerland. So I also call this the golden triangle of cipher machines, because this was the place in the world where the cipher machines used on the commercial market were produced. But now from the Golden Triangle in northern Switzerland, let's move to another area of the world, the Belgian Congo. You might have heard of the Belgian Congo. It was a Belgian colony until 1960, and then it became independent. And the first president of Congo was Patrice Lumumba. Well, he was elected in 1960, but he didn't have this job for very long, because on January 17th, 1961, he was murdered. He was shot, or more or less executed, by a firing squad. And many details about this murder or about these executions are still unclear. So one question was the Belgian government involved? Perhaps it was some kind of revenge for the Congo becoming independent from them. Was the CIA involved? Well, Lumumba sympathized with the communists, so it's pretty clear that the American government didn't like very much what he was doing in the Congo, so it can evilly, or they at least had a reason for murdering him. If they were involved was not really clear, and as far as I know, it's still not really clear. The answer to these questions is unknown. And, well, all this happened in 1961, and from then, if we go ahead 40 years to 2001, so after four decades, finally the Belgian government decided to establish an investigation committee. Well, it took them four decades, which probably means that some people in the Belgian government were not really interested in such a committee, but after 40 years, it finally happened. And when this committee started working, they found 11 encrypted messages or 11 encrypted telexes in the files they had available. Here's an example. This one was sent from the Belgian Africa Ministry to Congo in 1961 on February 15th, which was about 4 weeks after the murder of Lumumba. So it was, of course, quite interesting, or it would have been quite interesting to read what was in this telex, but it was encrypted. So what the committee did, they hired the most renowned Belgian cryptologist, Bart Brunel, and they commissioned him to decipher the messages. They didn't pay him very much, and they gave him only 3 weeks of time. Now, as I said, probably some people in the investigation committee were not really interested in having these messages deciphered, but Bart Brunel, he had only 3 weeks of time, so he tried to do his best. And the first question he had to answer was, which encryption system was used back in 1961? It was clear that it was probably a cipher machine, because telexes were usually encrypted with cipher machines in those days. It was probably from Switzerland. Why? Because Belgium is a small country, and they probably didn't produce their cipher machines themselves, so they had no other choice than purchasing them in Switzerland. And there were contemporary witnesses who said, well, it might have been a Crypto AG machine, which is not really surprising, because Crypto AG was the market leader in crypto machines in 1961. And from the files, it became clear that a machine with a five-letter key had been used. So Bart Brunel looked at the Crypto AG cipher machines, and he found exactly one that used a five-letter key. It's the so-called C-35. It's named C-35 because it was built in it was introduced in 1935, which means it was already outdated in 1961. And it used the five-letter key, which you can see here. 1, 2, 3. Well, there are 5 wheels, and this is like a combination lock with 5 digits. And so it was the only machine he found with a five-letter key. And, well, as I said, this one was already outdated in 1961. In 2001, it was not very difficult to break this machine. There was even a publication in a scientific magazine, Cryptologia, which explained in detail how such a message encrypted with this machine can be broken. So, Bart Brenier felt very close to his goal. He implemented this breaking algorithm, and then he saw it didn't work at all. It was completely obvious that it was not this machine that had been used, because he didn't get anywhere. So now it became difficult, because he was looking for a machine with a 5-digit key, but in fact there was none. So the only thing he could do was look at other crypto AG machines. For example, this one, the CX52, but it has a 6-letter key. Or the C38, which also has a 6-letter key. Or the BC543, which also has a 6-letter key. So nice machines, and all these could be broken in 2001, but they were obviously the wrong ones. That's what he thought. So, well, he simply tried to start somewhere. He tried the C38. Again, this one was outdated, and it could be broken in 2001 with computer support, so he implemented this breaking algorithm, and to his big surprise, it worked. So, yes. So the message had been broken, and now the question was, why did it work? He was looking for a 5-letter key machine, but this one had 6 letters. Well, after some examination, he finally found out what had been going on. Well, basically, the Belgians used 5 letters for a 6-letter key. That means they used a key like this one, and the first letter was always used for the first 2 wheels, which is absolutely idiotic, because it makes the thing less secure. So it's still not known why the Belgian used this machine in this idiotic way. It reminds me a little bit of Murphy's Laws of Combat. Number 31 of Murphy's Laws of Combat says, professionals are predictable, it's the amateurs that are dangerous. I think this is what happened here. Of course, it's a stupid way to use this machine, but at least it fooled the cryptanalyst for a couple of days. Well, finally, it didn't help very much, but at least there was a delay in deciphering this message. So let's look at one of the plain texts. This one was sent a few days before the murder, and this part is especially interesting. It says, resume urgently plan Brasa with respect to Joseph. Well, Joseph was the codename of Lumumba, and Brasa was probably an abbreviation of Brazzaville, the capital of Congo. And now the question was, what was plan Brasa, and what did it mean to apply this plan on Lumumba? The answer is, we don't know, and it has never been figured out. Perhaps Plan Brasa means to kill Lumumba, and if this was correct, then this message would mean that the Belgian Africa Ministry gave the order to kill Lumumba, which would have, of course, been a pretty scandal. But it cannot be proved. Perhaps this Plan Brasa means something completely else. So does this mean that the Belgian Africa Ministry gave the order to murder Lumumba? We don't know. Could never be solved. So basically, we can say the crypto part of the Lumumba mystery is solved, but the mystery about Lumumba's death still isn't. So this is all I wanted to say about the golden triangle of crypto machines. Now let's come to a more technical chapter. So those of you who are familiar with some basics of cryptography will certainly understand what's going on. I hope it will be understandable for the rest too. Most of you have heard of the data encryption standard, the DES. The DES was the most important encryption algorithm of the early computer age. So let's say between 1975 and 1995, the DES was used virtually everywhere in ATM machines and in encryption programs and virtually everywhere. And this is how the DES looks like. It works on a 64-bit plaintext block, and it's a so-called facial cipher. Facial cipher, although the most important thing about the facial cipher is that it has two branches. So the plaintext is divided into two branches, and the one branch is fed to a certain encryption function, and the key is used in this encryption function, and the result is XORed with the other branch, and then the branches are switched, and the same is done again. And each step is called a round, and altogether there are 16 rounds, at least that's the way the DES does it. This is a faceless cipher. Here's a more general view on a faceless cipher. Can have more than 16 rounds. And this one was introduced around 1970 by the inventors of the DES, about 17 years or 15 to 17 years later. This concept was generalized to a faceless cipher with four branches. This time we have, as I said, four branches, and three of them are fed to this function, and the result is XORed with the remaining one. Well, this is an encryption machine from East Germany from 1976. Well, it was introduced in 1976. The algorithm it uses is a few years older. How did this algorithm work? Well, it was not known until 10 years ago, because usually these Cold War electronic machines are still classified, or at least the algorithms are classified. But then, well, a friend of mine, or a man who I know quite well, because he's also interested in crypto history, Bernd Lippmann from Berlin, he discovered a T310 cipher specification in a Berlin archive, which was, of course, quite interesting, because it's very rare that one encounters specifications of this kind from the Cold War. This specification fills about 50 pages. Here are two of them. So as you can see, this is highly mathematical, and I have to admit that I didn't understand really what was going on, but at least I could more or less respecify it or simplify it a little bit. And what I did is I published it in a scientific magazine in Cryptologia in 2006. And so this is, these are two pages from my publication. As you see, there's a lot of mathematics involved. I described everything. I didn't understand everything, but it was a nice publication anyway. I got a lot of interesting feedback. And then a few years later, a friend of mine, Nicolas Courtois, a French cryptologist, looked at my publication. And a few days later, he said, "This method is a faceless cipher with four branches." And I thought, "Oh, you must be kidding. This is an East German encryption algorithm from 1970 or so. It can't be a faceless cipher, because this was invented later, and the faceless cipher with four branches was invented 17 years later. It's impossible that something like this was used in East Germany in 1970. But I looked at this method again, and I created the following diagram, and I had to admit, he was right. This is exactly a four-branch faceless cipher. And this, in my view, it was a complete sensation, because nobody had ever known that East German cryptologists know this method as early as 1970. So if we can compare the DES with the T310 system, we see the DES was developed by IBM and the NSA. The T310 was developed in East Germany by cryptologists. This, the DES around 1972, the T310 around 1973, so let's say about the same time. The DES is a two-branch faceless, and the T310 is a four-branch faceless. How is this possible? I have no idea. There are three possibilities. First of all, perhaps IBM and NSA stole this method from East Germany. Maybe they had a spy there. Or perhaps East Germany stole this concept from IBM and NSA. Maybe they had a spy there. Or they simply invented a similar concept twice. I have no idea how it works. It's an interesting mystery. Perhaps one day one will find out. But there's even more strange about these two systems. The number of rounds the DES uses is 16. And this is enough because today we know that the DES can't be broken with 16 rounds. The T310 uses 120, though they were very cautious to say the least, or they wasted resources to say it in a different way. And the DES is used in the most obvious way. That means every encrypted bit is used. T310 only uses every 12th encrypted bit, which is a very strange way to use such a system. Nobody would do it today, but back in 1970, this is how it was used. That means DES is 1,320 times more efficient than the T310. It was a complete waste of resources, this T310. This means a Western block cipher machine was considerably cheaper, maybe by one order of magnitude, than the Eastern block cipher machine. And so if you ever, or my conclusion was, considering such a waste of resources, it is no wonder that the Eastern block lost the Cold War. Maybe we have finally found the reason for what happened 30 years ago. Okay, so let's now come to my last chapter. This one is about the double columnar transposition. It's another Cold War encryption system. Let me start with a couple of encrypted radio messages that were intercepted, or they were sent by an East German radio station, but they were intercepted by some German radio communication specialists and forwarded to the German Secret Service. And the German codebreakers from the German cipher authority in the late 1950s, apparently they were quite good. They could break all of these messages. I will explain later how it worked. And they broke them, and well, I can't tell you exactly what was in these messages because it's classified, but it is known, at least in general, what they contained. The first one contained birthday greetings, probably to an agent living somewhere in West Germany. The second one contained birthday greetings too. And the third one contained congratulations to the birth of a son. Well, this was highly interesting. Probably these messages were sent to a couple of spies who had a son in 1957, but it was impossible to say where the receivers were because these spies could be everywhere in West Germany or somewhere abroad. So it was certainly a success to decipher these messages, but this success could not be used, at least for 70 years. So let's go to the year 1974 now. In 1974, in Germany, we had a chancellor, or you would call it the prime minister. In Germany, it's the chancellor. His name in 1974 was Willy Brandt. And he had a little known personal assistant or personal secretary who was named Günther Guillaume. He was not very well known in the public, but he was pretty close to Willy Brandt all the time. He even accompanied him on his holiday trips. He was basically his right hand. And in 1974, there was a very faint espionage suspicion against Guillaume. It was not really serious, but at least an employee of the German Secret Service looked at these messages again, which were 17 years old now, and he saw that the birthday greetings from February 1 matched exactly with Guillaume's birthday. And the second birthday greetings matched exactly with the birthday of his wife. And his son was born exactly on the day when this congratulations to the birth of a son were sent. So this was an exact match. And Now the suspicion became a lot more concrete, and so the German Secret Service started an investigation, and it really turned out that Günther Guillaume was an East German spy, and he had told everything he knew about Willy Brandt to his East German East German Secret Service contact person. So this was a big scandal in the 1970s. In 1974, Guillaume was uncovered as a spy, and he was sentenced to 30 years in prison, and Willy Brandt had to step down as the German Chancellor, and Helmut Schmidt became his successor. Well, which encryption system did Guillaume use? It was the double columnar transposition, the DCT, which is a manual system. Well, of course, a spy couldn't use an encryption machine or one of these strange, random number generators, because this would have been suspicious. So he used a purely manual system, the double columnar transposition. This is how it works. Let's assume this is our plain text. Send supplies tomorrow at 11 a.m. We need two keywords. We start with the first one, which is, in this case, Rhein, which is a German river. What we do is we write the keyword in one line, and then the message is written line-wise below this keyword. Send supplies tomorrow. And the first encryption step is changing the order of the columns, in a way such that the letters of the keyword are now sorted according to the alphabet. So as you can see here, E is the first letter in the alphabet of this word, H, I, and so on. And the whole columns are rearranged this way. And now look at this letter here, N. This one is read out first. This one is the second, third. Well, basically, it's read out column-wise. And this is the NPTO and so on is our intermediate result. You can see it here, intermediate result. This is the plain text, intermediate result. And now the same is done again with a different keyword. It's done twice. This is why it's called double columnar transposition. And this is it. So the method you have seen here, it can be done completely by hand. You don't need a machine or a computer program or anything like that. So it's a purely manual system, but it's still considered very secure. And this is why East German secret services used this system in the 1950s. But how did West German codebreakers solve it? Well, they did it by guessing the keywords. Or at least, if you can guess one keyword, there are methods to get the second one too. But the keywords were pretty long, but the West German codebreakers found out that for this purpose, lines of poems were used. It is, to my regret, it's not known which poem was used in this case, but it could have been Das Lied von der Glocke, a very popular German poem, and it was one line from a poem. So there was probably a lot of trial and error work when the West Germans decrypted this, but finally they must have found the correct line of a poem, and then they could decipher a part of it, and the second keyword was a lot easier to find. Then this is how they broke it. So nowadays, of course, the double columnar transposition isn't used anymore. There are better systems, but it's still interesting from a historical point of view. And it's an interesting question. How secure is this very simple system today? This is also a question Otto Leibrich asked himself in 1999, so about a decade after the Cold War and when the system wasn't used anymore. He said, well, it would be interesting to examine this method, and why doesn't somebody publish a challenge? Just encrypt the text with the system, publish it, and let code breakers in all the world try to break it. Well, Otto Leibrich didn't do it himself, so I did it. I created this challenge, and this is it. I did it in 2007. As you can see here, this is one paragraph of encrypted text. The keywords are between 20 and 25 letters long. And Otto Leibrich said, I don't think this will ever be broken. According to his experience, was simply not possible. And I agreed, because I thought this is a method that was used by the secret services and it's well examined. If the keywords are so long, it should not be possible. But I was wrong. In 2030, I received an email from a man I didn't know. He was named George Lasry from Israel, and he wrote me, well, I have solved this double columnar transposition challenge, and this is the clear text he sent me. And well, honestly, I get emails like this 20 times a year, and always people told me about some great crypto mysteries they have solved. Usually it's the Voynich manuscript, sometimes it's something else. So it was for me just another mail from some guy who was probably wrong, so I didn't care too much about this letter, this email, and it took me about 3 weeks until I finally looked at it. And after 3 weeks, I finally found the time to take a look at it, and I saw that it was correct. So I was pretty amazed. So this extremely difficult cipher problem had been solved. And then I looked, well, who is George Lasry? I didn't know him, but then I got to know him, an Israeli IT expert. He had been completely unknown in the code-breaking scene, which is completely different today because he's one of the most successful code-breakers of recent time. But this was his first real success. And, well, I saw that this guy was a pretty good code-breaker. And meanwhile, we have become friends. He wrote his PhD thesis in Germany, so we have met a couple of times, and we share the same interest in code-breaking. He's, of course, the much better code-breaker than me. I'm more the guy who writes about his successes, and it's a lot to write because he's quite successful and in his field. And this message was solved now, and he even became a media star in Israel because it was spread to the media in Israel that he has broken this unbreakable code, and so he was invited to by TV stations. And this is an Israeli publication which is published in English. They wrote "Ultra Secure 100-Year-Old Code Cracked by Israeli Cryptographer," and as I said, for a couple of weeks he became a real media star, and he got a really interesting job at Google Israel. So what's quite an interesting story. Now, of course, a new challenge was needed, a new double transposition, columnar transposition challenge. I created one with my two fellow crypto enthusiasts, Arno Wacker and Bernhard Esslinger. Well, this time we used random letters between 27 and 34 keywords with 27 between 34 letters, which is really long and it's not practicable anymore. But in this case, we wanted to be really sure that it's not breakable. And in my view, this challenge can't be solved, but I was wrong last time and maybe I will be wrong again. So if you're looking for an interesting code breaking project, try this. Okay, so I'm almost at the end of my presentation now. Let me draw a very short conclusion. Well, first of all, it is clear that cryptology played an important role in the Cold War. I could also cover 3 or 4 topics in my presentation. It would have been no problem to talk about 10 hours about this subject, and maybe in 10 or 20 years it will be no problem to talk 4 days, because more and more gets declassified, more and more gets known about Cold War cryptography, and it's a really fascinating topic. And still a lot of information is classified. I hope this will be changed. This will change in the near future. And let me now finish with a quote by Otto Leibrich. I once asked him, "What was the highlight of your career?" And then he said, "It was my first meeting with our East German colleagues after the Berlin Wall had come down. For decades, they had been our enemies. Now we sat at the same table." Thank you.